Good morning, everyone. If everybody could kind of come in, get a seat. It's April Fool's Day. We have no tricks this morning, but we have a great crowd, a wonderful assembly of folks. We're so pleased all of you could be here. My name is Keith Burdette. I'm the Secretary of Commerce for the state of West Virginia. We are honored to be the host today for this event here in Chief Logan. We believe it is an important event, and what has impressed us in the process is the magnitude of interest from this entire region of the state in sitting down and talking about how we develop a smart, effective path forward in Southern West Virginia. It is, I just checked as I was coming in, a little over 200 people pre-registered for this event. So we are so proud to have you here. And I want to thank you, especially. At the end of the day, the effectiveness of this discussion is clearly based upon the quality of the participation. And I have been absolutely impressed by the sincere interest in today's events. We know we have many challenges to face, especially in Southern West Virginia, but let me make it very clear, your input is critically important if we are to have any success in charting an effective, positive, constructive, and effective step forward. So I don't thank you as a matter of routine. I thank you with great sincerity. We are excited about what we think we can develop in the course of this process. I also want to thank my boss, the governor of the state of West Virginia, for hosting this event. As you know, the issues facing Southern West Virginia weigh especially heavy on the governor because this is his home. This is his home, and it has been his home all of his life. He makes every opportunity to come back here to Chapmanville, and make no mistake, he is a Southerner through and through. He loves Southern West Virginia, and he is devoted to helping make it prosper. He has certainly been a cheerleader for this effort, and so we are interestingly, we're meeting here today in the Earl Ray Tomlin Conference Center, which obviously is named for him, but it's named for him because he was instrumental in getting it built. And there were more than a few skeptics. I happened to be in the legislature at the time. I can tell you that there were those who believed it was not a smart thing to do. Clearly, the governor not only was successful in getting it built, but he's proven them wrong about the effectiveness and the ability to use this facility to advance the opportunities in Southern West Virginia. So I think those of you who live here know the projects and the process and the progress that he's brought to the region. So I feel confident that you know there is no stronger advocate than the governor of the state of West Virginia for this region of the state. And so in keeping with that theme, I'd like to take a minute to recognize Governor Tomlin's Director of Government Affairs for a few words. Robbie Queen is truly a local boy, a Logan County boy. Many of you know Robbie, know what a great ally he is, and it always pays to have a friend in the governor's office. Robbie Queen's a friend to everybody in the governor's office. So Robbie, welcome aboard.
On behalf of Governor Tomlin, I too would like to recognize the hard work of the team that put this together today. It was something that the governor brought to their attention some time ago. Unfortunately, today we're able to bring it to reality.
Welcome to the discussion. Thank you to all of our state and federal partners who are with us today. And some of you have taken a great deal of effort to be here. To the team of the to the team of the development office, thank you for all you all have done to make this a success. Governor Tomlin is proud to represent this area during his time in the House of Delegates, the State Senate, and now as the governor of our great state. Not only has he seen the many challenges our state has faced, he has dedicated his life and his many years of public service to supporting our coal fields and the folks who live here. He has been a steady leader who has guided our state through many of our challenges and our successes. It's no secret that we find ourselves in the midst of a challenge today. While the governor continues to fight against federal regulations that threaten our miners, our coal industry, and our state's way of life, he noted during his final State of the State address in January, an unprecedented shift has taken place in our state and our nation. Forces beyond our control have severely damaged our coal industry, and even the most optimistic among us realize it is unlikely that coal will ever reach the production levels of the past. Recognizing that, we know we have to take a look at how we do things. We have to do things differently. It will take all of us working together, both collectively as a region and within our own communities and our groups, to chart a path forward. It's going to take fresh ideas and, quite frankly, some bold steps to drive our region to the next level. And that is why Governor Tomlin has convened this group today. As leaders within your respective communities and groups, you know the challenges you face. You have the willingness, the passion, and the determination to make things happen. Quite frankly, you can get things done. Later today, you will hear from Governor Tomlin as he outlines a vision for a bold, aggressive plan for a former mine site not far from here, a plan that has been in the making for a while and requires participation from both the private and the public sector. Until that time, my message to you is this. Governor Tomlin has never forgotten the men and women who have unearthed the coal used to produce the low-cost energy that fueled this country's industrial revolution. He never has, and he never will. During his remaining time in the governor's office, Governor Tomlin has placed a renewed focus on revitalizing Southern West Virginia, and he has personally been at the table to lead these discussions. The governor has stressed a sense of urgency to all levels of his administration, and I can tell you, it's a push that's uncharacteristic of this governor. He believes in this area just as this area has always believed in him. Again, thank you all for being here, and thank you for being part of this very, very important, critical, and timely discussion. Thank you.
Thanks, Robbie. We all of us that work in the governor's office appreciate the hard work that Robbie Queen does every day. I'd also be amiss if I didn't thank some other people and recognize a few other people. First, let me recognize the folks here at Chief Logan. They've just done a phenomenal job for us in the process and the planning and the preparation for today's event, and I please give them a hand. They've done a great job. Also, I think it's important to recognize Randy Dameron, who's the man behind the curtain, who is taking care of all the sound. You know, do not look at the man behind the curtain. Never mind. Anyhow, Randy's doing a great job to make sure that everybody can hear us and see what's going on, and we appreciate it very much. We are also very honored to have with us a lot of folks from the congressional offices of the state. Clearly, this is on everybody's mind, what we're trying to accomplish in Southern West Virginia, and while our congressional representatives themselves are busy in Washington, they've sent a trusted and able staff to participate in the conversation. We want to thank them. From Senator Joe Manchin's office, Mike Browning is here, over here. From Shelley Moore Capito's office, Aaron Spork, who is the Director of Economic Development, and Max Hyman, who is the field representative for Senator Capito's office. And from Congressman Evan Jenkins' office, Chad Story is here. So over there. There are others you'll hear from today, but I especially want to recognize Jim McCluskey of the Appalachian Regional Council, who made his way here today to participate in today's events, all the way in the back. And my friend Tom Haywood will be a moderator of several of today's panels. And we appreciate Tom being here today. I also need to thank, which we'll probably do again, but I want to thank all the panelists who are here. We've worked very hard to try to assemble a group of smart, innovative folks who are doing some really serious work in and around Southern West Virginia. They've all agreed to basically drop what they were doing to be here today, and we are very profoundly grateful for the time that they're dedicating to this effort. You'll get to hear from them as the day goes on. I think you'll be as impressed as I am. I also want to make sure I recognize, we can't put everybody, you know, our biggest challenge in assembling this event today was trying to decide who to speak and who not to. We had so many great opportunities and so many organizations that we wanted to make sure that their resources were here for many of you to take an opportunity to talk to and find out what services they may have. We just don't have enough time in the course of the day to do that. And many of them agreed to basically set up a vendor area out here so that you could talk to them one-on-one about what's going on, what they're doing in Southern West Virginia, what they may be doing, and how they can help both you as an individual company and you as a community. And I'm very grateful for that. As I said, it's always a lot easier to stand up here and give your story, but they're going to do it one-on-one, and they'll be here all during the course of the day, and I encourage you to take some time. There are a lot of resources in our state, a lot of resources in our state that we can apply if we know they're there. When you recognize what's available, being able to utilize it is much easier. And so we've begun the process of trying to identify those organizations, those nonprofits, those companies, those institutions, those agencies of state government that can play some role to advance your communities and your businesses, and they've been quick to stand up and participate today. So I encourage you to do that during the course of the day. Our panels today will cover three broad topics. First, we're going to have a panel here that will talk about building a world-class workforce in Southern West Virginia. Probably the most important characteristic to building a stronger, better economy in the state as a whole and certainly in this region. The second panel will involve the quality of life through strong communities, and that is equally important. There is a major shift in business recruitment in our country today. My generation and the generation before me, we lived where we could work. Now, people are working where they want to live. And so looking at your community as a calling card to both companies and individuals is more and more important. And so we've assembled a group of people to talk about that specific area. And finally, a panel that will talk specifically about developing the economy of the region through business development projects and business development outreach. We've assembled this all for a very specific reason. It's no secret. There are serious challenges awaiting us. I can tell you that the best, smartest economists amongst us did not see the cliff. They saw the downhill, but they didn't see the cliff. And what has happened in the past several months, certainly within the past year, has caught everyone from the bean counters in Charleston to the economists in Washington a little flat-footed and unprepared, I might add, for the havoc that has been caused by a series of items, not only of which were the regulations affecting the coal industry, but the entire collapse of prices within the energy commodity market. I lost an election one time in 1994, and a friend of mine gave me a plaque after that election. And the plaque was pretty simple. It said, "When God closes a door, he opens a window, but it's hell in the hallway." Well, we're in the hallway. There's a window, but we're in the hallway. We have to find a an effective route to get to that next window. You've watched it happen in this community. You've watched the layoffs. I personally receive every WARN notice. Every notice of a closing comes to my desk. I've seen them all. I know the impact that they're having in communities across the state, but especially in this region. I watched about 3 weeks ago as 2,000 people, think about this, 2,000 people lost their job in Boone County, West Virginia. Had that happened in any community in this state, people would be lined up at the bridge. Instead, we are lined up in this room to identify a path forward, recognizing that our bones are strong, but we must put new meat and new muscle on our structure. The cold hard facts are the challenges are real. How we deal with them will be the real test for all of us. We're going to use this as a brainstorming session. Yes, we have a group of panelists who are going to speak and talk about what they're doing, and what they see as a path forward. But the real purpose is to elicit a much broader conversation amongst you. And we have a kind of structure under which we hope you'll participate. The question is simple. How do we revitalize? How do we reinvigorate? How do we re-energize the Southern West Virginia economy given the challenges that we currently face? And yes, it's an important question, but it will require generating both big ideas and little ideas. It's not always the big ideas, it is frequently the little, the cumulative total of the small ideas. So one thing is sure, as we work today as a group, we want you to be engaged in that process. Now, there's two ways to do that as the day goes on. First, ask questions. Make comments. Stand up. There'll be time at the end of each panel. We want you to think about the conversation. We want you to add your voice to that. And you can do it for at least a short period after every panel. But there's also another way that we hope generates some discussion and action. On your table are cards. They're small index cards in three colors. Three colors. On the blue color cards, we're trying to make this simple so we can assemble this all in some cohesive fashion that, quite honestly, we can share. On the blue cards, we want you to share barriers. Barriers that you see, specific barriers that you see. Barriers that you realistically believe we can address, that we have the power to address. What are those barriers to improved and higher educational attainment, to a stronger and more skilled workforce? What are the barriers to starting a business here in these communities or attracting larger businesses and larger industries to these communities? What are the barriers to a healthier lifestyle, to a greater community, a greater level of community pride and participation? And what are the barriers we aren't talking about that we need to address? On the yellow cards, we want you to share a solution. Many of you have very specific ideas about things that might advance us. So we want you to write those down. If you have an idea, something concrete, something that might chip away at those barriers or create an opportunity that we might not have seen, we want to hear those. And on the white card, tell us what the state and the federal government can do to be more effective partners. We can get more white cards, by the way. If there's something that we can do that can help you revitalize and reinvigorate Southern West Virginia. Now, I know you've noticed. If you haven't, let me tell you. We don't have a state budget right now. We're not exactly sure how that's going to work out. And so we don't want to start the conversation by saying add a dollar sign to this. But we don't want you to not think big because of it. Will there be vast sums of money? Let's assume there won't be. But that doesn't stop us in our tracks. That does not mean we can't make real, significant change. In many instances, it simply requires us to rethink our priorities, to rethink the way we approach the challenges ahead of us. I promise you, if you will take the time to write on those cards, I will read every single one of them. We will have them compiled in a format and give every single one of them to the governor of this state. We will share them with other departments and other people that might be able to look at your comments and suggestions in an effective fashion. It is going to be a critical part of our conversation. And today won't end the conversation. So let me make that very clear. Today is not designed to be a finite point, that we roll into town, we bring 200 people into the room, and we say thank you very much, goodbye. We're serious about this. The governor is obsessed about this. In his final 9 months, I can tell you he is he's got this budget thing over there, but he is obsessively focused on it. He is obsessively focused on it, and he knows that there may not be someone from the deep coal fields of Southern West Virginia in the governor's office in the future. And the steps that he needs to take in the next 9 months may be important to what ultimately happens here. So I can promise you this will be an ongoing conversation, but a conversation requires two people. It requires a discussion to go both ways, not one way. So we need your participation. We need you to spread this conversation beyond this room. We're really impressed and pleased by the turnout, but this is a fraction of the people that live in this community and are affected by the decisions that are being made. So we encourage you to reach out to those boards and those companies that you're involved in and those communities that you participate with to look for new ideas, new suggestions that you can bring to our attention. So throughout today's panels, be part of the conversation. Write it down. Ask questions. Help us tackle the problems facing us. And remember, the only way to eat an elephant is one bite at a time. Don't assume that anybody believes this is a one-hit wonder type of effort. This is a concerted, continuous, broad-based strategy that must be developed if we are going to reinvigorate the economy of Southern West Virginia and attract people back to the Southern Appalachian region of our state. So the governor and I can tell you, both have great faith in what we can accomplish. And I again say, we thank you so, so very much for being part of today's discussion. So now, at this time, I want to invite the first panelists to come up to the podium. Out there, all properly mic'd, but we do have a running mic if something would go wrong, so we should be all ready to go. We'll have lunch today. We've got refreshments outside. There'll be a couple opportunities to break as everybody gets situated. So it's no real surprise or a coincidence, I might add, that the first panel today focuses on workforce development. Governor Tomlin has made the development of a first-class workforce a priority of his administration. The first thing he did when he took office, there's some discussion about the wording of this. I tell everybody he fired everybody on the Workforce Council. He just says he reprioritized the participation. But basically what he did is he put folks at the table who were the decision makers. He elevated the discussion from mid-level officials and participants in these programs to the decision makers. And he chaired the meeting. Now, when you say that, we all chair boards. The governor is not a typical board chairman. With the exception of his cabinet, he chairs no meetings. But he is at every single workforce development meeting, every single one. And I can tell you, you will not ask questions today as hard as the ones he asks the participants of the Workforce Development Council every day. So it is an important priority of this administration. And when we look at workforce development, we're looking at a two-pronged problem: retraining displaced workers now and preparing the next generation to enter the workforce. We have five outstanding panelists today who work on both sides of that problem. And as I said before, the elephant in the room is the sheer numbers that we have to deal with. The number of displaced minors in Southern West Virginia is massive. It is a huge challenge. So I want to take a minute to tell you before we start the panel about a grant for those of you that we have, that for those of you who may not be aware of this. I encourage you to spread the word. West Virginia has received funding from the U.S. Department of Labor's National Emergency Grant for several years now. That's grant funding that comes to us because of the law, specifically because of the loss of jobs in the coal industry on so large a scale that it qualifies, even at the federal level, as an emergency. The money pays for minors to go back to school or get job training, or it will pay for the minor's spouse or children living at home going to school. It'll even help pay for gas, food, childcare. We've got a former miner here today who has benefited that program, and he'll tell you about his experience. But coal miners aren't the only ones who are displaced workers. We have a tremendous number of long-term unemployed folks in Southern West Virginia. Last year, we received funding for another Department of Labor grant to pay for on-the-job training for what is defined as the long-term unemployed. This program pairs employers who need specially trained employees with employees who would love the chance to get that type of training. The feds call it job-driven National Dislocated Workers Grant Program. We call it Let's Train. Let's Train WV. We've got an employer here today who has benefited from that program and can talk about it. The idea behind Let's Train is a grant fund, and its grant funding pays a new employee's wages while they're training up to $10,000 per employee. It's training that the employer designs and executes, and we pay the wages. That gives employers some leeway in who they hire and how they can participate. One of the biggest challenges in facing West Virginia companies who want to grow is training their existing workforce in new technologies. We have programs that can help with that. One of them is the Governor's Guaranteed Workforce Program. We have folks in the room who run those programs. This is a program that steps in to help for training of existing employees, which for some company means the difference between moving somewhere else or staying here in Southern West Virginia. That program can pay up to $2,000, depending on the wages, up to $2,000 per employee. It is the most highly flexible training grants in the country. One thing that has made West Virginia more attractive to companies, big and small, is the custom training our career and technical colleges provide. The way we've been able to work with Procter & Gamble in their training needs. Now, Procter & Gamble's not in Southern West Virginia, but it's an example of a huge company that has stepped in and used our training programs to be successful. This and more you can hear during this panel. So, first, we've got Dr. Robert Gunter, who was selected in November to serve as the president of Southern Community and Technical College. Southern is doing amazing work with training folks in this area, and he's going to talk about some of the programs they have to assist folks in your community. Next, we have Stan Stewart. Stan was laid off from coal mines, gone back to school to study biology. He's going to tell you about his future plans. He's going to describe the federal funds that made going back to school possible. We have Dr. Sarah Tucker. Dr. Tucker is the Chancellor of the state's Community and Technical College System, and she'll be talking about some of the specialized training programs our CTCs are offering. I think you'll be impressed. We also have Chuck King. Chuck is the founder and president of Cenergy. Cenergy is a great engineering, manufacturing, and construction company providing turnkey facilities for the natural gas industry. Chuck's company has utilized training dollars from both the governor's guaranteed workforce and Let's Train West Virginia, and can talk about the success of those programs. And last but not least, you'll hear from Dr. Kathy D'Antoni, who is the Chief Career and Tech Ed Officer for the state's Department of Education. Kathy is a true champion for getting our kids on a career path early in their life and making their future just a little bit brighter. She oversees some fantastic programs, and she'll talk about all of them a little bit today. So, Doctor, I'll turn it over to you first.
Thank you. Well, good morning. It's a pleasure to be here. And as I was introduced, I am the ninth president of Southern West Virginia Community Technical College. Been on the job about 90 days, but 90 days sounds like a long time, so I quit saying that, and now I say 3 months. So I have a lot to learn, but I've learned a lot, and would like to start off this panel by talking about some of the things that Southern has done and some of the things that we plan to do to reach out to increase the workforce in our environment. Normally, I would start with the associate degree level programs, but I'm gonna flip that around and talk about some of the very short-term type training programs that we have. And first, to let you know that we really are there in this community to do the training necessary for developing skill sets to get people to work. And if we don't have a program that's already established to do that, then we are willing and open at any time to discuss that type of program and develop it to the best of our ability and offer that training to provide those skill sets at a moment's notice. We currently have on our books skill set programs, which are the introductory level type of training that we do in a wide variety of areas that people can come in under a short term and get a certificate and go right to work. Those are programs such as bookkeeping, computer repair technician, early childhood education, paraprofessional, graphic arts designer, industrial safety technician, working in the legal office, medical office, payroll, records clerk, and tax preparation, plus many more. So we're available to do that. And you know, I found in a lot of the jobs in education, particularly in workforce development, technical education I've been involved in, we tend to be the best kept secret in town. A lot of really good, hardworking people, dedicated to what they do, but most of the community do not realize that we're there and exactly what we do. So it's part of our job to get the word out to let people know that we are there. The second level of programs that we have are our certificate programs. And through all the various divisions that we have at the college, we offer a number of different certificate programs that people can work toward and hold not only the college certificate, but also hold an industry certification of one kind or another. And I'm not going to go down a long list and read all these different things that you can get from us, because you can look online at our college catalog. But there are some new programs that we have that I'm excited about that we are in the process of developing and offering to our community based on a number of Department of Labor grants and state grants that allow us to build the capacity of our programs. So we have a new program called Health Information Management. We have new options in our Business Accounting and Business Administration program for energy, entrepreneurship, and healthcare. And we have new options within our office administration program in administrative, legal, and medical. We have new programs in our division of applied and industrial technology, which I'm really excited about because my background is very strong in the technical side, in a program called mechatronics and in welding. Everybody knows what welding is, but mechatronics is one of those new programs, a new name, a new invented name, which is kind of a takeoff of the maintenance technician. It's a person who comes in and learns those skill sets in mechanisms, gears, ratios, programmable logic controllers, and basic electricity and electronics, who can go into a shop floor and keep the equipment of that facility running to keep that program operating so that company can continue making money. So we have a number of new programs in that regard I wanted to mention to you. And of course, we have our degree programs. I feel like we have one of the best college transfer programs with a number of 2+2 agreements between different universities within our state, where students can come to Southern and take their freshman and sophomore year transfer courses and then transfer to any one of our in-state institutions where I say all of their credits will transfer into their program, but depending on what actual major they go into, all may not transfer directly into that major, but all will transfer into the program either as a major or as an elective. We've been out talking to high school students lately. We've gone to all the high schools that we are in our service region. And the big selling point I tell the high school students is, you know, English is English and history is history. Why not come to Southern and take our courses at a much lower tuition rate, where it saves you the college loan, it saves your parents from that college loan, and could, depending on your area of your major, it could save you up to $30,000 towards your final degree by starting at Southern and then moving to anywhere you want to go. So we have a number of outstanding programs available for students within our region. Southern is very unique in that we have four campuses spread across our service area in one site at the Lincoln High School. So students all across the broad area of the five counties that we serve have a campus of Southern very close to them that they can come and attend. Now, all programs that we offer are not always offered on each of the campus at the same time. Some of them rotate around. So it's very important for everyone to look online at our catalogs to determine what programs we have to offer. So we do a lot of work in customized training. I only want to mention a few. We, of course, being in Southern West Virginia, we've done a lot of work in mine management. Currently, we have an agreement with Unilin to do an apprenticeship program with them in mechatronics. We worked with the Hatfield and McCoy Systems in the past to do Excel training. We've worked with the Logan Mingo Mental Health programs, and we've done computer classes for them. I do need to tell you that we have mobile labs of a number of types, both in the mining and computer labs, where we can actually bring training to your facility and do that kind of training in-house. And we have the availability of online continuing ed courses, upwards to 300 plus different kinds of courses you can take, either just for self-gratification or working toward a degree of some type. Ron Lemon, who is one of my vice presidents, is involved with the foundation and does a lot of scholarship work. And he tells everyone that we have money to give. You have to apply for those scholarships. So in the past year, we have given out $319,000 in scholarship opportunities to over 300 individuals. We have basically 24 different scholarship categories with a number of scholarships fitting under each of those categories. And most of this money has come in, and these scholarships have been provided since our Major Gifts campaign started back in 2006 and 2007, which has been very beneficial to our students within our region. Through ARC, recently we have acquired $100,000 in scholarship money to give out to students, and this past year we gave out $37,000 to 45 recipients, and currently we have the remaining amount of money that we have to give out to recipients this coming year. So Southern is a vital component of this region, and in the short 3 months I've been on the job, I found that we have an excellent staff and faculty who are dedicated to providing high education standards and promote the educational level of our community every single day. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gunter.
Now, I've heard Stanley Stewart speak before, and he does a great job at this. So, ladies and gentlemen, Stanley Stewart.
Good morning. Like you said, my name is Stanley Stewart. I'm currently a senior at West Virginia State University. I'm majoring in biology education for high school. I'm a little long-winded sometimes, so I'll try to keep this as brief as possible, but they want me to give you a little background on myself. I'll be 37 years old in a few days. I'm married. I have two honorary young boys, one of them 13 and one of them 4. And I'm a lifelong resident of Boone County. I completed 5 semesters of college at Southern starting in the spring of 1999. But due to some circumstances at that time, I found myself following in the family's tradition as being an underground coal miner. My family has mined coal since the beginning of the 20th century, dating back to my great-great-grandfather. So it was natural. I was successful in the mines. I spent 13 years underground, 8 of them in a certified position, the last 3 of which I was the third shift mine foreman. I also had a lot of great experiences working with great men, and considering while we're sitting up here today, I thought I'd give you a little background on coal miners for some of you that may not be real familiar with them. Coal miners are some of the best people in the world. They're a different breed, I'll give you that, but they're great people. They're the kind of people that if you're broken down on the side of the road, they're going to stop and help you. They hold the door open for you. You know, they know how to laugh, often loudly, because none of us can hear. But they know how to laugh no matter how tough their situation is. And their work ethic is hard to top. These guys are used to performing their duties in adverse, often very dangerous environments. And they do them very well in the dark with each other. Because you get so tight with each other working in the coal mines, you also go through some horrible experiences. I've seen many guys with terrible injuries, known many guys who have perished. This time of year is very difficult for me and my family, you know, due to nearly 6 years ago, UBB, you know, the disaster. And I worked there and was very close with many of those guys. So it's very difficult, you know, and I myself have not been immune to injury. I've had 2 or 3 different surgeries. I'm missing a part, you know. But through all of it, you're very close with each other. You work very hard, and you make a lot of good money supporting your family. But on May 13th, 2014, our mine shut down, becoming another casualty of the declining coal industry. Myself, like many of my co-workers, began to fill out resumes to try to find a job. But then a friend of mine happened to mention something about this grant that would give me money to go back to school or be retrained. Well, I was intrigued because even though I made very good money and was very successful working underground, I always had this dream of going back to college and finishing my education. But kind of like how you fantasize about winning the lottery, I never really believed it would happen. You know, it was just a dream. But I was intrigued, so I went. There was a job fair for dislocated coal miners in Madison, and I went to check it out, where I found out that absolutely I could go back to school. Well, this was very intimidating because it had been nearly a decade and a half since I had been in college, and I was concerned that maybe I'd forgotten a lot of the things I knew. And, of course, I was concerned with finances. But when they offered me the $5,000 plus $20 a day for gas every day I go to college, it offered me a stepping stone. And it is all I needed, so I took that plunge. The problem, a lot of problems facing the coal miners, and it's the same things that we used to talk about when I was working underground. A lot of coal miners, they don't feel like they can do anything else. And the reason that is, when you spend the majority of your adult life in one profession doing a certain job, you begin to question whether you can do anything else, whether you could start over in another profession. They also get used to drawing that handsome paycheck, and you begin to believe that you can't make it without that paycheck. There's also, they don't think they can afford to go back to school. Myself, again, I was a mine foreman for quite a while, and I made pretty good money, so I had a little nest egg that assisted me. Some guys don't have that. So it's frightening for them because they feel like they can't afford to go back to school without drawing a paycheck they can't provide for their families. And plus you have a lot of guys that mention that there's really nothing else in this area that pays well enough for them to work. So these are just a few things that are concerns to coal miners. Remember, these guys are smart. Coal miners are some of the smartest people I've ever known. All of them may not sit down and write you a grammatically correct 500-word essay in 10 minutes, but they're smart in many ways. And all they really need is a chance. You know, they need an opportunity. For some of them, if they're a little deficient in their core skill sets, maybe we could design some sort of tutoring session, something that could help these guys be able to pass an aptitude test to return to school. Because it's a concern to a lot of these guys. Myself, I've been successful since returning to college. I'm a member of Kappa Delta Phi International Honor Society, on the Dean's List and the Student Advisory Council, and I'm maintaining a 3.91 GPA right now. Humor. But, thank you. And I don't say those things to brag by any means. I'm probably the most modest person you'll ever meet. But the reason I say that is because I'm not special, but what I've done is I've taken that coal miner's work ethic, that toughness and tenacity, and I apply it to books now instead of my back. And it's the same thing that these guys can do if they get the chance. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stanley. Our next speaker is Dr. Sarah Tucker, the Chancellor of Community and Technical College System, Sarah.
Thank you. Somehow I always find myself on panels right after the most eloquent and heartwarming speakers on the panel. I'm not sure how I always draw the short straw, but that seems to be that seems to be my fate. I am thrilled to be here today to talk about community and technical college education in the state of West Virginia. And that's because I'm so proud of the work that our community colleges have accomplished, and I'm excited about the future that we have ahead of us. I'm just going to briefly give you a little bio, if you will, of our community colleges. We have 9 community and technical colleges at 27 different locations across the state of West Virginia. We work with approximately 700 employers annually. I'm going to set a goal here today to up that number to 1,000 employers annually. The average age of our students is 28 years old, and about half of our students are part-time students. And I tell you that because I want to make it clear to you that the folks that are trained through our community and technical colleges are not your traditional students. They're not necessarily the students that just come right out of high school. These are students, as Stanley talked about before, who have families, who have competing priorities on their time, who need to be able to draw a paycheck in order to support their families, but who also need some additional skill sets and certifications in order to be successful in today's workforce. And so those are the folks that our community and technical colleges work with each and every day. And I'm very proud, as Secretary pointed out, all of the grant opportunities that are out there for retraining individuals, dislocated coal miners, dislocated workers. We now have some grant opportunities for TANF recipients. Many of those individuals are coming to our community and technical colleges and being retrained so that they can be successful in today's economy. I believe with the core of my being, as cheesy as this may sound, that community and technical college education will lead to occupational opportunities that will both bring people out of poverty and will retrain dislocated workers, and that community and technical colleges are the key to that retraining for the state of West Virginia. But we cannot retrain the workforce or train the workforce in the first place without the help of the employers. And I'm urging all of you employers who are out there, please come and partner with your local community and technical colleges and tell us what you need. We need you to tell us what skills you need in a workforce. We need you to tell us what certifications you want to see in your incumbent workforce. And we need you to tell us how many people you need. We work with employers on a daily basis through industry sectors. That is, we bring like employers together and try to make sure our programs are meeting their needs. These meetings have led to the development of many programs, including the mechatronics program that Dr. Gunter spoke about earlier. The mechatronics program, for example, that exists at Southern West Virginia Community and Technical College is similar to that exists at Bridge Valley, at New River, and at Blue Ridge Community and Technical College. That mechatronics program is going to be the feeder program for the 700 jobs that Procter & Gamble need by 2017 in the eastern panhandle of this state. We also have partnerships to work with employers, and that's what I want to talk with you a little bit about today so that you know what sort of opportunities the community and technical college system and your colleges have to partner better with you. Perhaps my favorite of those employer partnership opportunities is our Learn and Earn program. Our Learn and Earn program is a 50-50 wage match internship opportunity for individuals who are enrolled in our community and technical colleges. It provides individuals the opportunity to both be enrolled in a training program and to work with a company in their specific field and get a paycheck, as Stanley talked about, which is so important for our adult students, and also get the opportunity to be trained directly in the field in which they're going to work. So it helps the employer, and then it lets the employer have, let's say, a year-long interview process to see whether or not that individual is actually the person that they want to hire at the end of the year. But it also provides our students the opportunity to get the hands-on training that they need that works in conjunction with the classroom work that they're being instructed in at the community college. Further, it allows our adult students the opportunity to actually go to college on a full-time basis. Because if they're supporting a family, if they're supporting their parents, if they have bills to pay, which we all know everybody does, they can't go to college full time and not have the opportunity to earn a wage. And this Learn and Earn program provides them the opportunity to do that. We've recently expanded a Learn and Earn program with Pike Electric here in Southern West Virginia through New River Community and Technical College. We had started out with a cohort of 10 individuals in January. Working on electrical lines. Pike Electric was so pleased by the quality of those workers in January that this month they asked for another 10 individuals. So we have opportunities here for you, those of you who are finding yourselves displaced, finding yourselves out of work, for employers who are interested in training new employees. If you realize that you're going to have a workforce need that's coming up, many employers in this state have a high number of individuals who are just about to retire. The Learn and Earn program gives you a great way to see what your incumbent workforce might be and to train that incumbent workforce. So I encourage you to contact your local community and technical college or contact my office, and we can help you work out a Learn and Earn opportunity with your company. We also have opportunities for advanced grants. That is a pot of money that we use to provide both workforce training and to equip our colleges so that they're able to provide the type of hands-on training that you may need for your business. So, for example, the PTU that was just installed in Bridge Valley at their Advanced Technology Center in South Charleston used in part, use some of this advanced grant money so that we could get that type of equipment to the Advanced Technology Center so that individuals who are being trained in chemical process technology and mechatronics and in instrumentation technology could have the type of equipment that they would see actually in the workplace so that they were trained appropriately. We also have technical program development grants. These are grants that go directly to the college, but they are meant to meet specific workforce needs. So, for example, if your company comes to Southern and says, I have a need for 20 workers, and I need them to be trained in X, Y, and Z, and Southern doesn't have a program in X, Y, and Z, Southern can apply to the Community and Technical College office and say, I need some funds to start this program. And we can get the program started up right away. We also have tech scholar grants, and this is something that I would really encourage employers to think about. This is also a 50-50 match. If a company is willing to donate dollars for scholarships for students, the state will match those scholarship dollars 50-50 so that you can double the number of students who are ultimately going to be trained in that area. And so I encourage all of you to think about those grants. I encourage all of you to partner with your local community and technical colleges, and I look forward to speaking with all of you this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tucker, for your comments. Our next speaker is Chuck King, who runs a great company here in West Virginia, and he's going to talk about some of the programs he's engaged with.
Good morning. I have a story that's kind of similar to Mr. Stewart's. I've been in the natural gas industry all my life, and I was an employee of Columbia Gas in Charleston, West Virginia. And thanks to some Federal Energy Regulatory Commission rulings in the 1980s and the 1990s, I found myself out of work. The gas company was deregulated, and things changed the way we operated. When I was an employee of Columbia Gas, one thing that I noticed is all of the vendors that serviced the natural gas industry for West Virginia came from out of state. They came from Oklahoma and came from Texas. And that's where they felt like the hub of the natural gas industry was for the United States. Natural gas was discovered in Pennsylvania. If West Virginia and Pennsylvania were a country, they'd be the second largest natural gas producing country in the world behind the United States. The natural gas industry is kind of a sleeper in West Virginia, has been for years, but it's alive and it's real and it's big. So what I did after I was severanced with Columbia Gas, I went in business for myself. And we have an engineering, manufacturing, and construction company. And we design, build, and install facilities for the natural gas industry, mostly in the Appalachian Basin, but we ship products all over the United States. We located Cenergy in West Virginia. We've had lots of opportunities to move the company to the south, to the west, and we've stayed in West Virginia with the home facilities, the manufacturing and engineering and the corporate offices. Our construction crews work all over the Appalachian Basin and work through the south, and they work more west than ever before. The natural gas industry was booming, still is booming. It has slowed down some thanks to OPEC and the price of oil. But it's still very viable, a great industry. We'll be back. It's a little cyclic. Natural gas is a good alternative for energy to power this nation, as was coal and as is coal. There's plenty of need for both. Problems that Cenergy had growing, and we now have approximately 200 employees, West Virginia people, and we utilize subcontractors in West Virginia. We buy most of all of our materials out of McJunk and Redman, companies like that in West Virginia. And you know, we're very loyal to our state. Problems that the Cenergy had in terms of growth, in 2008, I built a compressor station here at Logan, up here next to the prison. I had a very big struggle at that point in time getting employees, getting welders, getting heavy equipment operators, truck drivers. We struggled getting employees. We struggled getting employees that could pass a drug and alcohol test. And we're on a random pool drug and alcohol test. I got people being tested constantly. And it can be a struggle to get. Once the coal mine industry started going down and started having surplus workers, I've hired a lot of coal miners. As Mr. Stewart has alluded, they've got good work ethic. You know, you've got to have people to design that plow, but you've got to have people that can pull that plow. And the coal miners, we've got them in quality control. I've got them as laborers, welders, truck drivers, heavy equipment operators. They're some of the best heavy equipment operators we've ever hired. And we were able to do that and cash in on a lot of the programs, just about every program that's been mentioned here this morning. We have got serious dollars from the state of West Virginia on several programs. Existing employees that I've had to send to different schools. It could be a certified welding inspector school in Texas. I get $2,000 a pop every time I send somebody to that school. And that doesn't pay for the whole ball of wax, but it pays for a big chunk of it. My observation, my deal, I feel like I'm the most blessed man in this room every time I walk in a room because I live the American dream every day. I've been very successful, and I don't know why, but we have been, and we've got some great people that work for us. I've toured every one of the community colleges, or several of them. We've hired people from the community, and they're just phenomenal. But for a kid coming out of high school, really doesn't know what they want to do, I highly suggest they go to a community college because you'll come out of there, and you'll go to work the next day. You can go to college and get a degree in psychology or archaeology or history, and you're going to struggle finding a place to go to work. There's a lot of natural gas in southern West Virginia. There's a lot of businesses. When the Marcellus Shale kicked off in Pennsylvania, there was companies that switched over. They were trucking companies, and all of a sudden they started hauling water. And in 1 month's time, they became a millionaire hauling water. The natural gas industry has a shale play in West Virginia called the Rogersville Shale. West Virginia's sitting right on top of it. And it's going to get explored. And that natural gas will be getting pulled out of there sooner than later. And southern West Virginia is full of natural gas, doesn't have the infrastructure to move it, to get it out. It needs to go south, needs to come north, needs to go towards the northeast. So there's a lot of opportunity for business owners in southern West Virginia and unemployed coal miners. There is a ton of opportunity. It's just to the point, and that's what this whole conference is about, is education and getting that ball rolling in that direction. But thank you for allowing me to be on this panel and anything I can ever do to help anyone. Because I hate to see people out of work. Whenever we're interviewing people, my human resources department has direction. If someone's out of work, they're going to get precedent over someone that's already got a job. Because I've been out of work, and it's not a good feeling. It really is not. And it's a chance that you take. It's very unnerving. I really admire Mr. Stewart and respect him for what he's going through. And I know what it's like to have everything you own hocked for your business and be laying awake at nights trying to figure out how you're going to make payroll the next day. And, you know, thank goodness you finally get past that point and it pays off in the end. But anything we can do to help, let us know. Thank you.
Just for the record, those of us who have worked with Chuck King know exactly why he's successful, whether he does or not. We're honored to have him with us today. Our next speaker is Dr. Kathy D'Antoni. She does a remarkable job in the public school system, and we're very pleased she could be with us.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm delighted to be here, and Southern West Virginia is very close to my heart, too, because I was born and raised in Wyoming County. My father, who's now 102 years old, I don't know if he's the longest living person in Wyoming County, but he's pretty close. But it is a very special place to me and in my heart. But there is some good news. Southern West Virginia has probably, as does the whole of West Virginia, one of the most valuable resources that we could ever have. But it has to be crafted, it has to be mined correctly, and it has to be paid attention to. And that is your emerging workforce. We have some remarkable, remarkable young people in this state. But we have to pay attention to that emerging workforce or they leave us. I have had many, many, many conversations with business and industry over the years that I've been in education. And the conversation went in the 80s and 90s from, okay, here are the skill sets we need from education. Here's what you need to teach students. That conversation went from that to the conversation that says, for God's sakes, will you just send somebody who'll show up for work, do a full day's job, and be drug-free? And forget the skill sets, we'll train them. I mean, it was loud. And I'm thinking, you know, what's going on here? We have students in our school that are remarkable. Something was disconnected. And I was beginning to wonder who's showing up at these folks' doors for jobs. Well, we started looking around. What happened was society changed from the 50s, 60s, 70s. It slowly shifted. And our kids came either from working parents, nobody at home, or single parents. All of a sudden, these soft skills that are critical for businesses to be successful were not being taught. And so we had the idea of changing a classroom. If it's hard to talk to teenagers, and I'm sure a lot of you have them here, they already have all the answers. So how do you explain to teenagers what it means? And this, well, not only teenagers, either fourth and fifth grade today, but how do you explain it? If you tell them, they sit there and they go like this, and they go about, and if you can get them off their iPod long enough to talk to you, or you let them experience it. If they experience it, then they understand it and they start seeing and they take on a new perspective. So what we did was we changed every one of our classrooms into companies, no longer a traditional classroom. That student applies to get into that company, they're interviewed to get into that company, and then they run the company. It's student-led. We have now in West Virginia over 1,000 companies. It will go past 2,000 next year because it's going to be required of every single classroom in career technical education. Senator Manchin asked me why all classrooms weren't like that, and I said, because I don't have control over all classrooms. I have control over. But we are seeing, it's been going on now for 4 years. We have welding companies, manufacturing companies, engineering companies. We have childhood, we have paralegal companies, we have legal companies, we have law firms. We have every company imaginable. They have CEOs, job foremen, quality inspectors. These students run the company. Teachers have moved from a sage on the stage delivering all the knowledge to facilitators. They deliver the skill sets, the information, the knowledge through professional development in the company. In 4 years, folks, I have never seen a transformation of a classroom that I have seen. These young people, and I wish I could have brought them here today because they could contribute to this conversation. And I'm going to say to folks in Southern West Virginia, invite the foremen and the CEOs of these companies to your discussions on workforce development. You will be shocked by the ideas that these young people have. They're not biased. They're not jaded. They don't see barriers. They're creating. They see possibilities. And it takes on a total different conversation when you're talking to these young people. In Southern West Virginia, I had a company at Wyoming County Career Tech Center that created and developed a commercial log splitter. Now, whether they can get it patented and whether it goes, but these are the types of things they did. I have one company that decided that they wanted to do moving solar panels. I don't know enough here to even talk about what I'm talking about, but anyway, they installed them with their company and their building. They saved the Wyoming County school system $15,000 in electrical bills for that 1 year. I had one student who was head of an engineering company. This company came up with the idea of doing a shield for a chainsaw. The governor saw and talked to these young people. Doesn't exist in the United States. We're kind enough, Guy Peduto, who's here, was kind enough, hooked these kids up with somebody at WVU and they got the idea patent. It needs to be manufactured in West Virginia. These are the things that are happening throughout our state, and in especially in Southern West Virginia, where these kids have this opportunity to move. They are doing safety inspections. They do the 5S on manufacturing, on quality control. Some of them get paychecks. That's an eye-opener. When you receive a paycheck and I get $2,000, the guy next to you gets minimum wage. They see that. Why? Well, you didn't come to school. You lost some of your pay. All of these things are happening, but the biggest piece that I'm very proud of is they are drug tested. That is one of the protocols of these companies. We are sitting in a drug-infested area, folks. It's got to stop, and it's got to stop with the young people. We got to pay attention. I've had no pushback on the drug testing from students. I got it from adults. And they're saying, well, what do we do with these kids if they test positive? You help them. If we don't catch them now in school, their lives are ruined, and we pay for it, society pays for it as they get older. Happy to say we have a 98% drug-free placement or passing of the test in West Virginia so far. We have had some positive testing, and out of those, we have gotten those kids help. But those kids have asked for next year to have 100% mandatory drug testing because they want a drug certification, drug-free certification to take with them if they go to get work or go to college. These are bright young people. So I guess in all of this, we need to pay attention to their, they need to have a voice. And by having voices, you're going to get ideas that you may never think of. So far, we have had 10 states and the country of Australia visit these classrooms to see what's happening because of the changes going on with these children. So I just say pay attention to our emerging workforce.
So now you see why we're so pleased with the folks who could participate today. This is a great group of smart, talented people who are doing some amazing things, both personally and collectively in their fields. So now's your chance to weigh in. Questions from the audience? Heather.
Get the attention of your friends and your colleagues? How do we get their attention to cross over and take advantage of these programs?
That's a good question, and it's a big problem as far as the word is not out there very well. I mean, many people in our communities have no idea about these programs. Since I spoke in Charleston, I think in October, I've had many of my friends that have lost their jobs call me and ask me, how did you go back to school? And wish I helped them. But what would really, in my opinion, help would be to have more, I guess you could say, job fair type deals. You could have them at local schools, kind of centralized. To get the word out, you could also have, in my opinion, more informational flyers or pamphlets. You could put them at post offices, you know, just places just to get the word out, because all it takes is a few people see those, take them home with them, and say, man, this is a really good deal. And then they spread the word, and more people, you know, inevitably more people get the word.
Other questions? Yes, sir.
This would be for Dr. Gunter and possibly Dr. D'Antoni. I've had the pleasure of meeting your father years ago, and I assume that Dan and Mike are your brothers?
Right.
Okay, I've met them too.
But she's the famous one.
Yeah.
Smart one.
But it has to do with education. I came to West Virginia in 1974 as a 21-year-old, and I was a broadcast journalism student out of Duquesne University in Pittsburgh. There was an opportunity here, and I came. Sadly, I never did finish college. I was three semesters short, but I was so excited about moving here. West Virginia was a great place to live. It was booming. But my concern now, I'm retired, but I do work as a property manager for a landlord. And I have about 8 rental properties. And it's really hard to get landlords. And what I notice, and then this goes back to education, that students at the elementary level, I think, are getting decent educations. And then, and Dr. Gunter and I, we talked about this briefly, then when they get to middle school, there's a little bit of a regression. And we have 3 high schools in our county now. And I saw a graph on the internet the other day where our 3 high schools are in the bottom 15 of the state. What would it take for our 3 high schools to get into the top 15 in the state? And what I'm noticing with these families that I rent to and do property managing work, I always believed that education began at home. I think teachers and principals can only do so much in the classroom. At the end of the day, those students go home and they're exposed, not everybody, but they're exposed to another aspect of life that may not be good. And I just wish there was some way that we could get the message across to our middle school students and our high school students that there is hope, but the ones that I've run into, they just have so little self-esteem, and they feel that they can't. And if they are a working coal miner, like somebody had said, they feel that they can do nothing else. And I was in radio broadcasting for 36 years, and I know about the shale drilling and natural gas, the conversion process. But I feel sorry for our young people and education in general, because I just don't believe there's a section of young students that just don't get the education from mom and dad, maybe because mom and dad didn't receive a real good education. That's for either one.
That's a great cultural question about how you change the culture of education.
That's why I've spoke on simulated workplace. That's what we're seeing. We're seeing a total shift in students. The reason is what happens in middle school, and You ask a person opinion at the age I am, I will give you my straight shot opinion. It may not be politically correct. But the problem is students are disengaged. They are, if until you turn that child on to where they see what it is for them and they get the interest, then we are fighting an uphill battle. That's why this program or initiative, it's not a curriculum, it's an environment where we put these kids in. Within a very short time, we are seeing students who are actively engaged. The attendance have gone up to schools, their achievement has gone up, and they are becoming more involved in their own education and taking accountable for it. And I ask these kids, because I've asked them from all over the state, why they like this. And believe me, it's short, guys. We've only been doing this for about 2 or 3 years, so we're still growing. But every single child looked at me and said, because we feel respected. Something's wrong when our educational system does not respect our children, or they may not intentionally not respect them, but something is happening that a student feels that way. So this changed the environment to where the student becomes accountable for their educational system. And that needs to happen, because until you get their buy-in, you can teach till you're blue in the face. And if they don't buy into it, you're never going to have a top high school. Once they buy into it, I'm telling you, there's no limit to what these kids can do. So that's my answer to you. So
I think the other cultural shift that needs to happen throughout the state of West Virginia, but in Southern West Virginia, particularly, is for people to start talking to kids about going to college. It has been for too long, maybe not for too long, for quite a while, students, particularly in Southern West Virginia, didn't need to go to college. They could get a coal mining job at a very high wage without having to go to college. That has changed. But the dialogue that we're having with students hasn't changed. We're not telling them that they need to go on to some form of higher education. And it's not that hard to have that conversation. I did my dissertation work on the college going of first generation rural students. And I asked them, what got you to college? What made you think about going to college? Almost down to a person, it was one conversation with one person. One person took the time to pull that kid aside and say, do you know what the opportunities are out there for you? Do you know what you could do? Have you ever thought about going to college? What are you interested in? What do you think you might like for your future? How do you envision your future? In order to get there, you need to go to college. And all of us are responsible for having those conversations with those students. All of us are. We need to take the time to sit down and talk with kids and make sure that they understand what opportunities are available for them, because the opportunities are there, but they need some form of higher education to be able to realize them and to actualize them.
I think that you know, society has changed, and the world we grew up in has changed now from what our kids growing up in today. Families are different. Not all families are two parents. Kids don't have the same type of home life that we may have had. I spent 30 years in the Alabama public school system before I retired. And one thing I noticed, not only with my own kids, but just as a instructor and as an administrator in the school systems, is that in elementary school, kids do so well because that's the first time that mama's baby's at school, and mom and dad are very involved in what happens at the elementary grades. But as the kids get older and move into the middle school and into the high school, the kids tell mom and dad, I don't want you coming anymore, leave me alone. And the parents disengage with the students. And that disengagement, I think, is a problem. They need to stay engaged. I also think as students move into the high school level, I really think business and industry needs to get more engaged in what happens in the schools. I read a report a number of years ago, and I apologize, I can't remember exactly, I can't quote the source of it, but it made a statement, it was a study that showed that schools where businesses were engaged almost on a daily basis within the school with some type of activity, those students performed better, graduated at higher rates, and were more successful in finding jobs than the schools where the businesses did not engage. So it's back to that old paradigm of it takes a whole village to raise a child. We don't have whole villages raising our children anymore, and we need to re-engage back into that.
Yes, sir.
Any of the institutions represented here, or any of you know, if there is any training offered for, and this is not very large, but training offered for tractor-trailer drivers. And I say that for this reason. There's a job that you can train for, make pretty decent money, still live in Southern West Virginia, because they go out maybe 2 weeks at a time over the road haulers and come back and make good money. And you can train. I don't know if that training's available here or not, but I think I've talked to some companies or heard of companies in West Virginia that are in logistics. They cannot expand because they can't get drivers. And drivers, of course, it would also involve the drug situation. Sure. But I just think that's an opportunity. Are any of you looking at that, or do you know of someone that's looking?
Yeah, Boone County has a CDL program affiliated with their school system. And as we're looking at some of the ARC promise money right now, Southern is actually having conversations about partnering or starting a CDL type program. So yes, we're having that conversation.
In fact, I think the number one program for retraining of coal miners right now is in fact truck driving. And the reason is maybe a little less encouraging. The reason is because they can stay at home and truck out and truck in either on a daily basis or a weekly basis.
I also need to mention, though, that if you look statistically at the turnover rate of truck drivers, is really pretty high. It takes a very special person to be a long-term truck driver. They make good money. It is a good job, but not everyone is cut out to do it.
Jim.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. My name is Jim McCleskey here with the Appalachian Regional Commission. Looking forward to being on the next panel. This is a terrific conversation. Thank you all. The question is a little bit of a segue to that, and I appreciate the mention of the power initiative from ARC. Dr. Tucker, I know you're doing some thinking about that as well. Let me point out to everybody, this gentleman right next to me, Mr. James Bush, who is the program manager for ARC here in the great state of West Virginia. We'd love to talk to everybody who has ideas on this initiative. We will talk about it further in the next session. Dr. Tucker, tell us what you have in mind, and let's get it on his agenda.
Okay.
Is this a pre-application process here? Okay, just checking.
Well, I was going to say, does this preclude my need to respond to the email if I do it right now? So what we are interested in is looking at the three colleges that primarily serve Southern West Virginia. So that's Southern West Virginia Community and Technical College, New River Community and Technical College, and Bridge Valley Community and Technical College. And thinking about creating, for lack of a better term right now, centers of excellence at each of those colleges. And so those colleges would be responsible for a succinct set of programs that would be different in each of the three institutions. And we want to look at an open entry model for those programs. As Russell Fry and Valerie tell me all the time, people don't get laid off on a semester by semester basis. They don't. They get laid off on a Wednesday, on a Thursday, on a Friday. And unfortunately, our colleges aren't always appropriately set up to intake individuals when they are laid off in the middle of a semester. And so we're going to be working, and I've talked with Dr. Gunter about this, we're going to be working on creating some programs that are known for being open entry programs. And by having these centers of excellence, then maybe we can have three or four programs at Southern, and then three or four programs at New River, and three or four programs at Bridge Valley, and suddenly we have 12 programs. Our colleges aren't equipped right now to have open entry programs for every single program that we offer. But if we target those programs that we think will be of the most interest, that are the most in demand, then we have the best chance of getting folks who need to be retrained and retooled into those programs. It is my hope that those open entry programs will also be on some sort of an accelerated format so that we can get people through as quickly as possible and get them back into the workforce.
Oh, thanks. I have kind of a technical question. It has to do with the labor market information's out there and the federal projections of the in-demand occupation codes. So when you develop, when CTC develops their certificate programs, how does that information come into play? How often? And does the factor of post-employment wage rates for certain occupations, does that ever go into factor into your decision? Well, we're going to promote radiology technician, for example, as opposed to CNA.
Yes, in the development of new programs, that's exactly what happens. The institutions look at we use EMSI software, the system office, and provide that information to the community colleges to look to see what the industry projections are. But the problem with industry projections is that industry projections are based on what's happened in the past and not necessarily what's going to happen in the future. So that's why sector strategies, which Mark Julian from our office works on so closely with, and that's why sector strategies become so important. Because you can't just rely on that data, because that data can't predict significant changes all the time in the future. And so when you partner with business and industry and talk with them about what their needs are and what they project their needs are, that becomes another piece of the puzzle that we use to determine what programs we start.
Has there ever been, at some colleges and universities, nationally, there's been some wild talk about, okay, if I get a CNA degree and it only pays $9 an hour versus radiology technician, which is something else, your per hour cost for that credit hour, you charge less?
Do we charge less for the...
I know we don't, but has that discussion ever taken place? Or should it?
For some of the high-tech programs that have faculty that cost more money, that are supply heavy, there is an additional fee attached to those programs so that we can afford to run them. Yes. No.
Yeah. And I would look at those programs as career pathways. So someone that would come in as the CNA level, I would be recruiting and promoting them to move upward through that pathway to a higher level as they moved along. So we would offset costs in that regard.
Other questions? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I so much look forward to the discussion here today, and I don't have time to, I've got a lot of ideas. I won't take up a lot of time, but one of them would be, you know, people like Stanley, who got the help that they needed. And, you know, since the education panel is kind of here and they'll give their views today, I think that the state needs to look at further incentives for people to get an education. You know, we know that we have a great workforce here in Southern West Virginia. Myself and both my wife were educated locally at Southern. We're degreed, we work here, we live here. So we see the benefits of that program. And I would like to maybe for the state to take the approach that people need incentive to do something. And nothing is greater incentive for everyone in this room and everyone in our region than a monetary incentive. And someone who is going into a healthcare field, something that is needed. My wife's a nurse. So, I mean, we know that there's a national shortage of nurses across this country. And, you know, male nurses could work anywhere in the world they want to go. I mean, let's just face it. I mean, that's simple reality. But if someone would go to Southern or one of these other community colleges, and, you know, my wife's a two-year nurse. She went on to Marshall. She got her four-year. Once they come out of college and they were educated in West Virginia, they stay in West Virginia, they work. Let's just say, you know, someone goes to Southern for 2 years. Once they enter the workforce and they stay here, maybe the state could look at maybe subsidizing. And I know nobody wants to cut taxes, but like I said, you've got to give monetary incentive. Why don't the state look at, okay, you've got a two-year degree, you know, we're going to give you a 50% reduction on your state taxes for 2 years, maybe a trade-off. You know, if you get educated for 2 years, you come out 2 years of your workforce, and that goes along with helping, I think, on a national level. We hear a lot in the national scene that, you know, a lot of people are upset because they have high student loans. That would further give them an opportunity to put a little bit more money in their pocket. If you go 4 years, give them a four-year credit. You know, I'd like to see it be 100%, but I know a lot of people in the Capitol probably wouldn't like that. But, you know, and a doctor, you know, let's take our kids, let's get them in, and let these kids know that they're out there. You know, if you go to school for 8 or 9 years, I mean, get something for that. You know, so, and look at that as an incentive to our young people. Look at that as our incentive, you know, Stanley, going into the educational field. I'm sure he'd like some kind of a income tax credit for the time that he's putting in. So he's nodding his head. So it's going to work. I mean, I think it's a no-brainer, and I think that goes along to the gentleman's point over here to my left where he says maybe, you know, the kids aren't seeing that because they're not educated. The parents maybe not be educated. Well, let's get the parents educated now, you know, and it's not too late for them to go and get an education. You know, and we have wonderful programs and wonderful colleges, and like I said, I'm a product of that myself, and I see it as a win for our state, specifically our region.
Kind of begs another question. You know, especially to Dr. Tucker and Dr. Gunter, there are a lot of programs out there, and you all talked about a lot of them, and a lot of opportunities for people to go to college free. And I know as far as those that don't qualify for every scholarship, while we stack up very well nationally as far as the cost of going to college, it can seem to be daunting to people when they look and say, I've got to come up with several thousand dollars to go to college. How do we break down those barriers to get to those kids and adults and find a path forward for them? How do we communicate that message better?
Well, some of the work that has come out of our Gear Up office, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Gear Up program in the state of West Virginia, but it's a program targeted at low-income students to try to get them to go to college. And one of the things that they have been the most successful at, and it's only in a few counties, it's a federal program and funding is limited. One of the things that they've been most successful at is communicating to students that college in the state of West Virginia is affordable. And it is. It remains to be affordable. We have a number of financial aid opportunities that are available to students. I'm sure everyone's heard of the Promise Scholarship, which is an opportunity for students who have academically performed well throughout their high school career. We also have a grant opportunity or funding or opportunity called the Higher Education Grant Program, which is a program for folks who are low income, who have performed, I think the GPA is 2.5 during their high school career, and it provides opportunities for those students to pay for financially or to pay for college tuition. We also have the HEAPS program, which is a Higher Education Adult Part-Time Student Grant Program. And that is a grant program targeted directly to offset the tuition and fees for adult students in the state of West Virginia who are interested in going back to college. In addition to that, we have the programs that have already been mentioned with Workforce West Virginia. We have programs with TANF. We have the Tech Scholars Program for students who are in the technical fields when business and industry have created a match. Then you have Perkins funding, and you have Pell eligibility, and there are all of these different financial opportunities out there for students, and the Gear Up office has been incredibly effective at communicating those opportunities to students and getting those students to understand the true cost of going to college, which in West Virginia is significantly lower than it is in other states. The problem is that it's a very hands-on thing, it's a very hands-on program. And you have to really, really, really coordinate those activities at the high school level very well. And it's only at the high school level. It's not being coordinated with adult students at all. It's a lot easier, as my predecessor always said, it's a lot easier to outreach to high school students because you get them in the gymnasium and they're a captive audience. It's a heck of a lot harder to outreach to adult students. And so we've been looking at ways, the Higher Education Policy Commission, Chancellor, and myself have been looking at ways that we can take the success of the Gear Up program and model that, particularly as it pertains to financial aid across the state, in a way that the commission and the council can afford. But if any of you have any ideas about ways that we could do that more effectively or places where we could target adults or better outreach to students, I'd surely be very happy to hear what those suggestions might be.
Thank you.
So at Southern, we started a major gifts campaign back in 2006 and 2007, and through the generosity of individuals and businesses and industries who have donated money to our foundation, we turned that money right back around to scholarships for our students to benefit those students. And we say scholarship, and when you say that, you think, well, you've got to have a 3.0, 3.5, whatever. That's not necessarily true in a lot of the scholarships we have. We accept lower GPAs, and the sad thing is there's been a number of scholarships we've had over the years that have gone unawarded because students did not apply for them. So we have become much more active in the short time I've been there in talking with high school students, and Ron has challenged them. He has challenged them that, you know, last year I only offered 5 scholarships to this entire student body. I challenge you this next year, let's award 10 or 15 or 20. So let's get the money in the hands of the students who need it so we can offset the cost of their education and help them move forward in life.
We have one more question.
Hi, I'm Jamie Dempsey Butcher from WVU Extension, 4-H Youth Development here in Logan. And I think one of the issues that needs to be addressed, and I'm wondering how you will address it, is with Mr. Stewart, I'm sure when you stepped out of college the first time, it was because a financial, probably an issue where you needed to be able to get in a position where you can make more money faster. So, and now that you're stepping into education from being a third shift foreman, in my family right now, I have 2 brothers-in-law who have recently lost employment because of the coal mining industry. That college doesn't seem that attractive to them because the positions that they're going to get with those degrees do not pay nearly what they have adjusted their life to in the coal industry. So how can college be more attractive to the adult who's been working in the coal industry and have adjusted their life to a much higher income than they can get with, say, an education degree?
Well, I know myself, I wanted to be a teacher when I was in high school, and I actually steered myself away from that because I saw the salary they made compared with other professions. But I decided to, when I wanted to go back to college, I decided to do something that I was passionate about and that I felt, you know, I would really enjoy, which is I always wanted to be a teacher. So it's a trade-off. You know, I'm old enough now and I've been around enough to understand that although money and material things are great, if you're miserable, you're miserable. So I'm going to do something. I'll live by my means. You know, of course, I'll make a lot less than I made underground, but that's my intrinsic motivation. I want to be happy doing what I'm doing. And but you're right, absolutely. A lot of people, again, they feel like they can't afford to go to college for years upon years, and you know, they're not bringing in a paycheck while they're going to college a lot of times enough to support their family, so that's a problem. And you're right, there's not a whole lot of industry here that they feel like they can jump right into a high-paying job with a college degree. As far as trying to motivate them to return to school, to me, a lot of the motivation is job security, because working in the mines in today's time, you never know if the gate to the mine's going to be shut day to day, and if you're going to have a job, and it's hard to live like that. It's hard to live afraid to buy a vehicle or afraid to spend any money at all. So I tell a lot of my friends that are still working in the mines or recently laid off, I encourage them to return to school, get some kind of training. Myself, you know, I try to tell them, get out of the mines if you can now, because you're going to fight this. There's no end in sight at this moment. And to try to do something that makes them happy and that they will be okay and they can be successful.
Let me tie a final string to this, because we've had an outstanding discussion today. A recent survey, and this is for the community's perspective, a recent survey of CEOs and site consultants who were working with companies about expansions, relocations across the country. 94% of the CEOs who are about to make these decisions said their number one condition was being able to access a skilled workforce. Number one, by far. Even among the site consultants who are paid to look for sites, by 93%, just slightly less, the number one condition of looking at a community for a potential expansion or location was the accessibility to a skilled, highly skilled workforce. This is an incredibly timely discussion about the future of the workforce in Southern West Virginia, and I couldn't be prouder than the job that our panelists have done today. So please join me in thanking them for their efforts. Now, we're going to take a very quick break. I want to remind you again of this. We have people here that are here to help you find solutions. The Small Business Development Center, Christina Oliver and her folks are here in the building. Our Workforce West Virginia folks, many of the grants, they are here located outside. We have people here that can help your business learn how to export. The international office, Steve Spence and his folks have a table outside. Later in the day, the Robert C. Byrd Institute will come and talk about how they can help your business reposition. So let's take a 5-minute break, get something to drink, take a little refresher, and then we'll come back for the next panel. Thank you all.